to talk about feminism and humanitarian interventions, because I've been reading and I've been studying, and my views on the matter have changed a lot, especially my definitions for certain key terms. So let's start with defining feminism.
What does feminism mean to you?
Equality.
I think equality.
Are equal to each other.
Equal rights.
Gender equality.
Feminism is just another word for equality. It means equality, and no one would object equality, no one should object equality, and it just means that women should have equal rights as men.
So, most people would define feminism as equality, or more, striving for equality, which was almost exactly what my definition was before I started studying international relations. For me, it had always meant striving for equality between gender. However, it's not that easily defined, especially with intersexuality coming into play. Within international relations, feminists refer to people who want to stop something from being more powerful than something else. There are definitely a lot of misunderstandings and miscommunication within the field of feminism and outside of the field of feminism.
People think that feminists are people that want, that see women as higher than men.
Sometimes it seems a bit too one-sided.
It's the idea that some people have about it that is very negative.
That they want women to be better than men, even though they just want them to be equal.
For the purpose of this video, I want to talk about three different types of feminism. Firstly, feminist constructivism, which focuses on the rethinking of international politics by adding some social layer to it. Basically, feminist constructivism focuses on how the ideas that people have about gender shape global politics. The second type of feminism is post-colonial feminism, which concerns colonial relations of domination and subordination that were established under imperialism. And thirdly, liberal feminism, which state that equality can be achieved by removing legal and other obstacles that have denied minorities from the same rights as others. The critique that feminists have on international relation theories, they usually refer to the Enlightenment, as all the knowledge that was gained there and the terms that were created were usually by men, so it was very homocentric. And this gave them the realization that women can't be studied in isolation from men, as if language is gendered, everything is gendered.
I would say that the international relations, it has always been very man-centered.
Men have been in charge for so long, they have ruled the world in a certain way, and maybe women would do it in a different way. Has a different view probably on world politics and on international relations.
It brings light to perspective of the world, because there are men and women in this world, so they should both be represented.
If we're not equal in that sense, even gender, then how can we be equal in race and everything else? So I think that, well, that.
For this video essay, I'm going to prove that humanitarian interventions are not necessary for improving equality. When talking about the combination of feminism and humanitarian interventions with my best friend Tessa, she addressed the upcoming female political activity in Rwanda. Rwanda's history has been marred by the extreme effects of colonization and genocide. However, nowadays Rwanda is a model for females in positions of political leadership, as it is the first country to have a majority of women in the legislature at 56%. So in conclusion, their political environment is better than other countries without a humanitarian intervention. Why is this? Are humanitarian interventions even necessary then? I don't think so, and this is why. First of all, I'm going to talk about the beginnings and the endings of humanitarian interventions. So let's have a look at the general course of a humanitarian intervention. It starts off with a very bad situation where human rights are badly violated. So dominant countries, and usually these are the Western countries, feel the need to step in and act as some kind of savior for the country that is falling apart. However, after this saving act, women usually just fade into the background again.
In actuality, the people who are most impacted are the people on the bottom of the chain, and oftentimes these are the women, the mothers, the ethnic minorities, and oftentimes these are the majorities of the population.
Women are usually not liberated, and there's still a case of instability and conflict within the country, and sometimes it even ends up being worse than before. They say that they want to save women, but then proceed to drop bombs that kill thousands of the people they are trying to protect. To get back to the example of Rwanda, they didn't need humanitarian interventions after one of the worst violations of human rights of all time. Why would it do others any good if they did it all on their own and in a better way than I've ever seen before? Secondly, which is definitely the more debatable one of the three, but I still want to address it, is culture.
There are cultural differences between different countries, and that some different countries have different values and
especially related to the rights of women, for example.
As I've discussed before, everything can be seen as a social construct, even gender. And if social constructs define how you see the world, then cultures can differ immensely. It would be wrong to force our views onto them just because it seems right in our culture and in our ways. Humanitarian interventions don't always save the day, and richer countries are not always the heroes who know best. This can be linked to post-colonial feminism due to the Western countries save the day kind of idea that is based off of the older colonial relations that Western countries had, which I believe is wrong. Thirdly, the intentions are wrong.
You touch on the issue of motive here. And, you know, I suppose I would see it for the most part as a cover for self-interested motives in virtually all cases.
Usually international interventions, even though it's justified by being humanitarian, have double agendas with alternative motives that bring gain to the state intervening. For instance, control or natural resources or the figurehead puppet leader kind of thing.
Practically, the problem is that there can never be a sufficient long-term plan, sufficient well intentions, sufficient benevolent motivations, or a sufficient harm analysis to counter the fact that individual organisations and international organisations are fallible and they will always make mistakes. And it is the fallibility of those groups that means humanitarian intervention has to be a contradiction.
Look at what happened in Iraq and Afghanistan. It's hard to call that a humanitarian intervention. Personally, I would label that as war. As I mentioned in the first argument, although intervention is usually promoted as a peace-building pursuit, it often ends up being quite violent. While it is certainly true that, to some extent, Iraq and Afghanistan were formally presented from a humanitarian point of view, in actuality, the motivations were not purely altruistic, as there were definitely a lot of national interests involved. Sometimes the country that's intervening is only intervening because it makes them look better if they save the women.
One should not underestimate the significance, by the way, of personal enrichment as a motive for the interventionist impulse. Most of the major CIA covert operations during the Cold War involved personal enrichment by people who were involved in the operation.
This is based on the current popular idea of gender, where women are very victimized. This can be linked to feminist constructivism, as it comes from the way that our ideas of gender shape global politics and thus influence interventions in this case. A counter-argument would be, which is what the liberal feminists state, is that women equality can only be achieved by removing legal and other obstacles that have denied them the same rights and chances of men, and that thus humanitarian interventions could help. However, I think that the way in which Rwanda has achieved this exceptionally good political environment is proof that without humanitarian intervention, countries can save themselves in an even better way.
And I think most striking example, less known one, is Indonesia in 1965, where the CIA helped engineer a coup and then helped orchestrate a massacre of people that led to about 500,000 deaths. It's one of the really great massacres post-1945. Yes, indeed, on the scale of what happened in Rwanda, at least approximately. And that was something caused by intervention.
I wanted to step in for a second because I feel like my point wasn't really coming across in the original video. Of course, what happened in Rwanda is still a horrible, horrible genocide, and I'm not trying to undermine that. And there are some people who would say that a humanitarian intervention could have ended this earlier. However, as I've mentioned before, a humanitarian intervention doesn't automatically mean that it would have ended earlier. Could have also just made it worse, because that often happens with humanitarian intervention. And then the country ends up with a genocide either way, and a bad outcome. So the point I was trying to make is that in Rwanda, at least there was a positive outcome on the matter of equality. And that's why I think humanitarian interventions don't specifically do anything good, and gender interventions don't work.